his life changed with a little telegram. Telegrams were the way people communicated long distances 150 years ago. You had to lay a wire, and then someone had to click out little dots and dashes. Anyone remember what that's called? All right, I have an M&M thing that Rich Fuller gave me just before the service. If anyone can tell me the first name of the guy who invented the Morse code. Someone over here. I love a gracious winner. Telegraph, teletype, telewoman is what he said. I don't know. Everyone's a comedian. Anyway, his life changed with a telegraph. Back then, because it was laborious to type it out, each word had its own set and own code, or each letter. And then on the other end, someone had to write it all down. So people actually paid by the letter. And so messages were very short. And I wonder what he thought when he got this telegraph. Probably reflected a little bit on his life. His name was Horatio, and he was a businessman, a lawyer and a businessman in Chicago. He got married to a girl named Anne, and they had one child, a son. And then in a moment, his life changed. The Great Chicago Fire, which was started by Mrs. O'Leary or Mrs. O'Leary's cow, at least that's the legend. But he lost his whole business in that fire. But not only did he lose his business, but his son contracted pneumonia and died. So he lost his business and he lost his son. They had four more children. Four girls, he restarted his business. He became successful, so successful that they booked a ship to go to England, which was the homeland. And so he and his family were going to get on this ship. But at the last minute, he had difficulties at his workplace. So he had to stay behind. So he put his wife and his four daughters on board the ship. And then he promised to follow in a few days later. 4 days into the journey, almost across the Atlantic, the ship with his wife and the four children collided with an iron ship from Scotland. And later on, he heard from his wife that she got all four children up on the deck, and they knelt down and they prayed, wrote the names of the daughters, Annie, Margaret, Bessie, and Tanita. They prayed that God would give them the strength to endure whatever happened. The ship went down in 20 minutes. It sunk. 3 hours later, a fishing boat happened to be going by that place and noticed some debris from the ship and noticed that a woman was lying on that debris. So they picked her up, and it turned out to be Anne, Horatio's wife. And they brought her on board, and then later another ship came and took her and dropped her off at Wales. And it was in Wales in England that she had this telegraph sent. And the telegraph was simply these words: saved, alone, what shall I do? So Horatio, of course, got on the next ship, and as he was sailing across 4 days later, the captain of the ship knocked on his door and said, "We're probably over the spot where your family was lost." And so Horatio walked up on deck, went to the railing, and looked over the empty ocean. And supposedly that's where God gave him the words to the song, "Peace Like a River," or "It Is Well With My Soul." We're in this series on hymns. We looked at Amazing Grace. We looked at the doxology last week. Today we're looking at Peace Like a River. It has two different names. It Is Well With My Soul, or Peace Like a River. I want to look at the verses and the supporting text behind it. But the overall question that I have for you is, or can you sing those words, "It is well with my soul"? And how do you sing those words when it's not well with your soul? How do you sing, "It is well with my soul," when things are not well with your soul? So the first verse, if you have that little thing, you can look at it. If not, make sure you get one after the service. Verse 1, when peace like a river attendeth my way. Now, it's interesting. He's standing on the deck of an ocean ship, and he's looking out on the ocean, and he's talking about a river. And I think, you know, the kind of river that I'm thinking about is more like a stream. You go to a nice stream, and the water is sort of running down it, and maybe he was thinking of some stream in Illinois. I remember when we lived in Vancouver, we used to take our kids, Jeffrey and Joey and Mikey and Benny. That's what you call kids when they're little. Put a little Y on the end. We would take them to Tynehead Park. And Tynehead Park had a nice little creek river thing going through it. And what's fun is, even though you're in one spot, things keep changing because the river keeps going, and you play all kinds of games. You drop things into the river, and you watch them go, and you try to chase them. I don't know. Kids spend a couple hours doing whatever they do at a river. And as parents, you sit back, and you watch them. And it's a great thing. It's fun at the time, but it's even more powerful when you start thinking about it many years later. So I'm wondering if he's thinking about his four daughters, you know, playing in some river, and he's looking at that, when peace like a river. Back then, it was peaceful. It was there wasn't all this trauma. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows flow. A billow was a wave, the things that, you know, that impede a ship's progress. I don't know if it was a wavy night on the ship or not, but he's looking at these swells and these waves. And so what he's talking about is, you know, there's the good times when peace is surrounding you, and there are these times when the waves of life and the difficulties are coming at you. Either way, whatever my lot, whatever happens, taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Does that verse remind you, or does that idea remind you of any verses? A couple of verses come to my mind. One is Philippians 4. I had that in the booklet here. Paul says, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. He's writing the Christians at Philippi. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. So they sent him a gift. But he says, I am not saying this because I am in need. Why? For I have learned to be content in whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. And why can he say this? I can do all things through him who gives me strength. Another one is Job. Remember, everything was taken away from Job. And in the end, he praises God in the good times, and he praises God in the bad times. I remember my church plant in Vancouver, before we started, it was 2 weeks before the grand opening, and there were some people helping us. There was a kind of a launch team, and one of the guys got to know, we actually stayed in his basement for a month or two, because we had nowhere to live, and just before we started the church, I got a call at 1 o'clock in the morning, and it was a call from the morgue, and they said, could you come down? One of your teammates, his son, got in a motorcycle accident and was killed, and we need you to come. He's coming, and we need to identify the body. So I got to the hospital, and they lead you down to the basement. Never been in the basement before, and walking down the corridor with this father towards a room where possibly his dead son was lying. Can you imagine walking that aisle? So we walk in the door, and there is his son. It was his son laying just on the table. And he acknowledged that was his son, But then before he left, he gave testimony to his faith to everyone that was sitting there. In a way, he said, it is well with my soul. Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Now, I want to come back to this verse in the song, because I wonder if it really was well. I mean, he's saying this, but is it really well? Anyway, we'll come back to that. Verse 2. And the way I learned this song, verse 3 was actually verse 2, so I want to go to verse 3. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. Do you know what bliss means? Bliss is an old word that just means happiness or joy. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole. Now, what is sin? Sin are those things that separate us from God and separate us from people. Sin is those things that we do or don't do that lead to brokenness in our relationship to God and brokenness in our relationship to the people around us. Adam and Eve fell into sin. The first thing they did is they had to hide from each other. They no longer could face each other in their nakedness. There was brokenness. God came around. They hid in the bushes from God. They couldn't face God. That's what sin does. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Now, I want you to picture Horatio. He's standing at the railing. He's looking out on the very spot where his four children drown. Maybe he's thinking about how, you know, what they went through. It's this grief moment, and he's talking about sin. Now, why in the world would he be talking? He should be like either angry at God, because that's what happens, you know, when bad things happen to you. One of the first responses is to blame somebody. Somebody is to blame for this. And if it's not a person, then it has to be God, because he's in charge of everything. So you'd think that's what he would be doing, angry, kicking stuff, throwing things overboard. But he's thanking God for taking care of his sin. What's sin? Now you got to think about it. I think when negative things happen, we do end up blaming. We get angry, and we blame the people around us. Kick the dog. Usually take it out on our family and the people closest to us. But after a while, after we've sort of gotten out our anger, generally that anger turns inside. Anger outside is blame. Anger inside is guilt. Now, what would he feel guilty about? If you think about it. He lost his business in the Chicago fire. I mean, it's some freak thing. It happens, and all of a sudden, he lost his business. He builds it up again. They're going on this trip. And at the last minute, he can't go. So they go without him. My guess is he's standing at the railing going, if I had just gone, if I had gone, I would have done something. I could have saved them. But the business, this business, God tried to teach me. You know, maybe you start thinking, you know, God tried to teach me the place of business when I lost it all in the Chicago fire. And I didn't learn that that's not what's important. So I think he's thinking of his own guilt. And I think that's what we do. When bad things happen, eventually the guilt comes inward, or the anger goes inward. So he's standing at the railing, maybe thinking about his guilt. And then he thinks about what Jesus did for him. My sin, not in part, but the whole. Even whatever guilt I feel for not being there, is nailed to the cross. And I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Colossians 5:24. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful nature to the cross and have crucified them there. Remember one Good Friday, we actually had a cross up here and we had you write down some of the sins, things that are causing brokenness between you and God and brokenness between you and the people around you. We had you write them down. And then we actually nailed them to our cross. And what's nice about that image is you nail it to the cross, and at the end of the night, you go home. And where's the sin? It's there. It's not going with you. A lot of times we confess our sins to God, we give our burdens to God, and then when we stand up, we just put them right back. It's like a knapsack. We're running around with all these bricks in our knapsack, and we're trying to do things. And then we come to church, and we lay all our bricks down on the altar. And then at the end of the service, we carefully pick them all up, put them right back in the knapsack. Leave them on the cross. Verse 2 or verse 3, depending what version of this song you do. Though Satan should buffet. How many of you read buffet? Though Satan should buffet. Is a buffet bad? Is it, you know, is it of the devil? I don't know. Maybe it's, you know, when I go to a buffet, I can't stop eating till I've tried everything. It's a Dutch thing. You paid one price. The price actually goes down per ounce or pound of whatever you eat, the more you eat. So the cost per ounce goes down the more ounces you consume. So that's kind of a Dutch thing. I remember when we were in college, we would go down to Florida, you know, the spring break thing, and a bunch of guys, we would eat once a day. At night, we'd go to an all-you-can-eat buffet, and all day long, you have absolutely nothing. You're dying going in to the buffet, and you're dying going out of the buffet as well. Good to be young. Though Satan should buffet, it's really a sailing term. It's when the wind is against you and it's keeping you from getting where you want to go. Satan. See, there's a personality behind the evil. It's not just evil out there in the world. There's a kingdom of darkness that is working against us. Though Satan should buffet, make it difficult. Though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control. The word control, that's I want to just pause on that. Control. What is controlling you? Is it your trials? Is it your fears? Is it your anger? Is it your tragedies? Is it the difficulties in your life? Are those things controlling your life? Let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and hath shed his own blood for my soul. What is the controlling influence in your life? Is it the circumstances of your life, or is Christ the one in control of your life? Colossians 3, 1 through 3. Since then you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. This verse is a very simple verse, but it's difficult to do because we live here on this earth. We have stuff happening every single day. Tomorrow you're going to go off and there's going to be things that happen and things that you have to deal with, or at least that's what you think. It's hard to step back and look at the whole. What's the big picture? We're here for a short period of time. We're here by the grace of God to work in his kingdom, to do the things that he's called us to do, and he's going to give us the power and the ability to do it. So all the stuff that happens in our life, it's you know, sort of out of our, it's up to him. I don't control all these things. I don't control what's going on in this country. I'm called to do whatever I'm called to do. That's all I have to do. The rest is his problem. All right. Then there's a couple of verses to this song that most people don't know. They're not in the hymn book, but as I read them, you might get a sense of why they're here or why Horatio wrote these verses. For me, be it Christ hence to live, if Jordan above me shall roll, no pang shall be mine, for in death as in life, thou wilt whisper thy peace to my soul. He's talking about the Jordan River. Now, in the Bible, rivers were obstacles. The children of Israel get to the Red Sea. Pharaoh and all his chariots are coming to destroy them. It's an obstacle. How are we going to get across? God provides a way. They get to the Jordan River. It's at flood stage. They want to go into the promised land. God has been leading them to the promised land. They're almost there, and they get there in this water at flood stage. It's a barrier. And so God provides a way for them to get across safely to the other side. So the Jordan River, the river is some kind of a barrier. And what he's talking about as the Jordan River, or using the metaphor, that it's death. Death is that river that is sort of in the way of getting to heaven. That we got to go across this river, and it's a difficult river. And those of you that have had family members die in the past, you know how difficult it can be. The waiting, the slow anticipation, the sense of finality when it happens, all the different, the suffering that you watch someone that you love go through, and it seems to go on and on and on and on, and you want it to end, and you don't want it to end. It's a difficult thing. Well, this verse is talking about how God holds our hands through that, that we do have to go through this difficulty. We have to get through the Jordan River. The people of Israel had to get through the Jordan River, but God provides a way. So he's standing, Horatio's standing at the deck. How's he going to get past this? Lost his son to pneumonia, lost all four of his daughters to this tragedy. His wife is waiting in Wales. She's been without him for the last week. How are they going to get through this? Verse 5. But Lord, 'tis for thee, for thy coming we wait. The sky, not the grave, is our goal. So he's looking at the grave. What are they going to, how are they even going to do the funeral? They don't have bodies. Where are they going to do the funeral? How's this going to go? O trump of the angel, O voice of the Lord, blessed hope, blessed rest of my soul. And these two verses, you can see why he's talking. He's talking about the big picture of life, heaven, eternity, our hope that does not lie here on the earth. You can see why he's talking about that, why he's thinking about that as he's looking over the ocean. And then the triumphant end of the song, verse 6, generally verse 4 in most hymnals. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back like a scroll. You think of the clouds, and you know how a scroll is opened up. The whole sky opens up. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. And I had you read 2 Corinthians 5, 1 through 10. For we know that if the earthly tent, which is our body, we live in, is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, so we have this prepared for us, but meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling. Because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked or vulnerable. For while we are in this tent, in this body, we groan and are burdened because we do not wish to be unclothed or naked or vulnerable or full of fear, full of anger and all these emotions. Instead, with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal will be swallowed up by life. Now, the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit, as a guarantee. So that sense of God inside of us that gives us hope when there is no hope is the Holy Spirit speaking to us. It's like a little taste. Once in a while, we get these little tastes in our life that life is more than what we see. That's the Holy Spirit speaking to us. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. And then this verse. For we live by faith, not sight. This is sort of how he ends his song. We live by faith, not sight. And so I want to go back to that first verse. First verse is really the most unbelievable verse. If you think of him standing there at the side of the deck, you know, overlooking the ocean, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, well, that's what he's experiencing now, the sorrows like sea billows. Whatever my lot, it is well with my soul. Really? You think it really was well with his soul? He's standing there, the loss of his children, doesn't even get to say goodbye. Doesn't really know where they're at. You think it really was well with his soul? I don't think it was. If it was me, it would not be well with my soul. My soul would be broke. I'd be in the questions of why is this happening? Where do we go from here? How do I get excited about anything? How do I go back home? How do I get on with my business? How does life carry on? How is it well with my soul? The ending verse talks about living by faith, not sight. There's a little hint in the first verse. I had never really saw it till I looked at it this week. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say. You notice that? Thou hast taught me to say it is well with my soul. And so you know what? I'm going to say it. Because you taught me to say it. I'm going to say it. I don't feel it. My soul is crushed. My soul is empty. My soul is yearning. But I'm going to say it. Because I walk by faith, not sight. I want to walk by sight. I want to see. I want to see God. I want to see his presence. I want to experience the reality of these things. And we get these glimpses, but we walk by faith. We hold on to things that we can't see, that we can't always grasp. But I've been taught to say, by you, by my experiences of you in my past. And so in this moment, I'm going to say these words. I may not feel it, but I'm going to say them in faith anyway. And maybe that's what some of you need to do in your own life. You're facing things that are overwhelming. They're like, you know, I like this sea billows thing. It's these waves come at you. And that's what grief does. Grief comes in a wave. You're just doing something, and all of a sudden, this wave of grief just comes across you. And you don't even know why. Some of you struggle with depression, and it just comes. And if you tell someone, they just say, well, you know, God loves you, and life is good, and think of all that you have. Yeah, I know all those things. Yeah, exactly. But this is how I feel. It's a wave. It just washed over me. We live by faith, not sight. We hold on to something. Sometimes we feel it and sometimes we don't. So this song became more powerful to me because I can experience the sadness and sometimes the feeling of being alone. And it was sort of interesting. Last night I came home and all my kids are home and all the grandkids are home. And they're watching, what's the name of that? Inside Out. Have you watched that?
Yeah.
Oh, you got to watch this. Is it a Disney thing or what is it? It's a Disney, Pixar or something. It's an animated thing and memories and things. And, you know, everyone's goofing around playing Carcassonne last night. And me and the 1-year-old and a 3-year-old and a 7-year-old and the 6-year-old are watching this movie and with Grandpa, and Grandpa's bawling his eyes out. They didn't get those subtle parts, but it's a cute little movie, and it's about what's going on in someone's head and their memories, and you really can't explain it. But one of the characters is sadness. Everything she touches turns to sadness. And then there's the optimistic one that's always in control, wanting to control things and want to keep sadness away from the whole thing. But in the end, it was sadness that saved the day. That sometimes being sad is just what it is. And it's sometimes the sadness and the brokenness and the dysfunction of our lives that allows us to just lift our hands and say, God, I can't really do this. It's not in my control. And I know it's not in my control. It's obvious it's not in my control. So I just give it to you. And though I can't see it, I can't feel it sometimes, I'm filled with all these different emotions that I have no control over, I want to just give it all to you. I'm going to trust you. I'm going to walk by faith, not sight, trusting that I will see. One day I will see. And maybe I'll see sooner than I think. Let's pray together. Lord, some of us this morning can sing with gusto, "It is well with my soul." We know you, we've talked to you, you're real to us as can be. We know that you died on the cross to save us from our brokenness that separates us from the people around us, separates us from you. We've experienced it, we feel it, we're ready to sing and shout it. We can almost taste it. But there are others who are struggling, trying to figure it out, and the weight of things, standing at the railing, looking over into the emptiness of the sea filled with all kinds of trouble and things that just wash over us. And it seems like we have no control over any of it. Lord, I pray especially for those this morning who are struggling in that way, that they still will be able to sing, "It is well with my soul." I will sing it. I will say it because you taught us to say it. And I will say it in faith, but I pray for the day that I can see with my eyes. Pray this in Jesus' name, amen. This time we'll have the offering. If you're new here, we have a little slip. You can fill that out and put it in the basket as it goes around. And are we singing a song during this, or what's the ending song?
Just my soul.
Okay. So let's do the offering first, and then we're going to sing "It Is Well With My Soul." Four-part harmony. By the way, if you're new here, we're trying to learn the parts. We have a CD that has all four parts. And next week is Stand Up for Jesus. There's only two parts. There's the melody and the tenor guy part. So you guys, get with it this week. Listen to it 100 times. You will know the tenor part. We're going to sing this song, four-part harmony. Why don't you stand? And if you're a tenor, come on over here. If you're an alto, come on over here. If you want to sing the melody, just stay where you're at. And the basses are going to be over on this side. And if you need a sheet, there it is. All right, so who's singing the tenor over here? Follow these two guys if you're singing the tenor. This guy's singing the bass. Alto, soprano,
so
melody.
Bass.
Yeah.
There's
all right.
Bass note.
Okay, the bass note.
Ooh, let me hear you guys. Ooh, there we go.
Tenor.
Ooh, alto.
And then the melody is when... Okay, ready?
When he...
Join us for a little fellowship through the double doors, and those that need prayer, please come to the front.